Good morning.
Morning, Father.
Good morning.
Morning. Hey guys, my name is Michael. I want to just welcome you. We're calling this time before Mass a call to worship. And so I'm calling all of us to come and worship our God. They've been doing it upstairs there with some music, but we've been doing it with our gathering and our excited greetings to one another. We just want to take this time before Mass begins, first of all, to say welcome. You are very welcome here in the Transfiguration House of God. We're so glad that you are here. And we also want to take a moment to acknowledge that all of us come with a reason. There's a reason why we're here today. There's something we're praying for. There's someone we're praying for. And we want to become a community where we know one another better and we share more of ourselves with one another. So this is a place where our faith comes alive. And so one way to do that is before Mass begins to share that prayer that you have come with the person next to you and just say, would you pray for me during this Mass? This is what I'm praying for. We do that. And could we also share our name? Because some of us sit by people that we don't know their name. Week after week, we just have to say, remind me what your name is. See you every week. Tell me your name. Let's stand now and do that with one another. Share prayer, share names. Good.
Wow. I can't yell any louder.
Good morning. Please take a quick glance at your worship aid. We need to begin this celebration and would appreciate it if you would join us on our gathering song.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the Lord be with you. So gather here in this beautiful morning, let us see God's peace and mercy, and we'll kneel and pray the Confiteor together. And so we pray. I confess. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us into everlasting life.
Kyrie eleison.
God, author of every mercy and of all goodness, who in fasting, prayer, and almsgiving have shown us a remedy for sin, look graciously on this confession of our lowliness, that we who are bowed down by our conscience may always be lifted up by your mercy. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Exodus. In those days, God delivered all these commandments. I, the Lord, am your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, that place of slavery. You shall not have other gods beside me. You shall not take the name of the Lord, your God, in vain. For the Lord will not leave unpunished the one who takes his name in vain. Remember to keep holy the Sabbath day. Honor your father and your mother, that you may have a long life in the land which the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not kill, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor, you shall not covet your neighbor's house, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, nor his male or female slave, nor his ox or ass, nor anything else that belongs to him. The word of the Lord.
Lord, you have the words. Lord, you have the words. You have the words of everlasting life.
Lord, you have the words. Lord, you have the words. You have the words of
the law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The decree of the Lord is trustworthy, giving wisdom to the simple.
Lord, you have the words. Lord, you have the words. You have the words of
the precepts of the Lord abide, rejoice in the heart. The command of the Lord is clear, and light in the eye.
Lord, you have the words. Lord, you have the words. You have the words of
the precepts of the Lord.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, Jews demand signs and Greeks look for wisdom. We proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are called, Jews and Greeks alike, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Glory to you, O Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory to you, O Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Wondrous and great, unveiled, but on every word that comes forth from the
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Since Passover the Jews was near, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. He found in the temple area those who sold oxen, sheep, and doves, as well as many money changers seated there. He made a whip out of the cords and drove them out of the temple area with the sheep and oxen, and spilled coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And to those who sold doves, he said, "Take these out of here and stop making my father's house a marketplace." His disciples recalled the words of Scripture, "Zeal for your house will consume me." At this, the Jews answered and said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered and said, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was talking about the temple of his body. Therefore, when he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they came to believe the Scripture and the word Jesus had spoken. While he was in Jerusalem for the feast of Passover, many began to believe his name when they saw the signs he was doing. But Jesus would not trust himself to them because he knew them all and did not need anyone to testify about human nature. He himself understood it well. The Gospel of the Lord. We are given 168 hours a week. For those who survive the week, 168 hours. A good chunk of that time is spent sleeping, or at least attempting to sleep. Another chunk is done or is consumed by eating food. For some of us who are commuters, it's driving back and forth to work. Another chunk is work. And there's not much left over. What do we do with it? In today's first reading, we hear this list of commandments, or a partial list of commandments. And one of them is to keep holy the Sabbath day. A day set aside for the Lord. For Muslims, Friday. For Jews, on Saturday. For Christians, it's supposed to be on Sunday. But we're often way too busy, consumed by things that have creeped into Sunday a day of rest and worship. What do we do? I'm going to sound like an older person. Actually, I'm going to sound like my father. Walk uphill both ways in the snow. And in my day, when I was growing up, stores were not always open on Sunday. The mall, when I was young, was just the mall, who is going out of existence these days, was just beginning to open on Sunday. Some restaurants were closed or not open until the afternoon. People went to church. There were no sports played on Sunday except for those on TV. Now, everything is on Sunday. Some of us look to Sunday as a day not of rest, but of catch-up. Not the red stuff you put on fries, but catching up from all the things that we didn't get done during the other 6 days of the week. For others of us, it's going to kids' or grandkids' sports events or recitals or dance things or whatever it might be. It's no longer a day of rest. It's a day of work. You look at the story of Genesis, the creation story. Do we really think that God got tired? Like on the sixth day, he's going, oh my God, I'm so tired. Oh me, I'm so tired. I can't go on, I need to rest. It wasn't the case. He modeled the day of rest for us. And yet we don't think we need it. Oh, some of us save up our rest for vacation. And then we're so busy on vacation, we come back and need a vacation. Because we can't go away and miss on the excursions of the cruise and all the things that are part and parcel of that trip. It's like going to Disney and you're up, get up at 5 a.m. earlier than you get up at normal day. And you go to bed late at night because you have to maximize the experience of vacation. And so some of us get no rest at all. For those who are retired, you thought retirement was going to be a time of rest and recreation. Some of you are busier in retirement than you were working. And some of you have had to go back to work for various reasons. So where's our day of rest? Where's the time to recuperate? And a day given to the Lord. When I moved to Flowery Branch, my last assignment, that was in 2010, Wednesday evening was sacred day in the school system. There was nothing scheduled in the schools on Wednesday evening because that was Baptist church night. And over the 10 years that I was at Prince of Peace, that day got taken over by the school activities as well. Even for the Baptists. At some point, we need to take back what was given to us by God. It's one of the Ten Commandments. It's right up there with thou shalt not kill, keep holy the Sabbath day. God didn't say these are some lesser commandments and these are the greater commandments. He said keep holy the Sabbath day. And yet the Sabbath day is no longer holy, no longer set aside, no longer sacred. We'll get to church if we can. I hear confessions every week. Father, we didn't make it to Mass this week because we were traveling to a sports event. What is more important? Our relationship with God? Our time just to rest? And for many of us, we have this American mentality, we have to just keep plowing through. I have to be busy all the time, because if I'm not busy, I have become lazy. Remember as a young kid, my dad would come home from work, he worked midnights on Fridays, so he'd come home Saturday morning, 8 o'clock. And if we weren't up, we had to get up. He would go room to room, knocking on the door, kicking the bed, get up. Well, he got us up so we would get out so he could go back to bed. We have lost the understanding of just being. We have lost the understanding of being at rest. We have lost the understanding of dedicating time just for him, a time of faith and a time of family, a time of worship and a time of rest, because we have so many things that we have to accomplish. Why? Why do we think that we have to accomplish everything? And why do we think that we don't need to rest and give a day of worship? I gave this homily last night, and I thought this person heard me, but Evelyn did not. And she said, on the way out, she goes, "Oh, good, you got it done in and out in less than an hour." And I was like, I often feel like Charlie Brown teacher up here. Wah, 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 wah. You guys don't listen to anything that I say. And I thought this homily would have been heard, and she walks out and, "Oh, good thing you got us in an hour." So I hope you hear me. I know that sometimes church seems as a boring experience or something you have to get done on a Sunday morning or Saturday night. I hope it's not that. Our relationship with God isn't about that. Or is it seen as that? But that it's an integral part of who we are and who God is calling us to be. And time set aside for him in worship and in rest, time with family and faith, is not a bad thing. It's a necessary thing. It's necessary time for us to recoup and to be in relationship with him and one another. Now, before anyone sends me an email, because I usually will get these, is it okay if I work in my garden? If you don't see it as work, then fine. If it's something that you enjoy and you go out and plant your flowers and do whatever, that's fine. But if you sit there and go, "I got to go out and lay mulch down today," no. You know, when I was in Israel, the first time that I was very ignorant, still am, but ignorant about this, and I went there, and the tour guide says, "Don't go on Shabbat elevator on Saturday." I was like, "What? Okay." He didn't really explain it any further than that, but he says, "Don't get on the Shabbat elevator on Saturday at the hotel." So the Shabbat elevator stops at every single floor. Doesn't matter what button they're pushed, it just goes floor by floor by floor. So you can be there for a very long time on the elevator if you're on the 10th floor. And I questioned him afterwards. I said, "What's the story?" He goes, "Oh, Jews can't push the button. They can't push the button on the elevator because that's work." I said, "Oh, come on." I said, "How the heck do they get in the room? Do they not put the key in and push the door, or do they stand there and it opens for them?" I'm like, this is the logic in Israel. So anyway, and they all go to the hotel on Saturday to have dinner because they don't want to cook dinner. But they're okay with having someone else cook dinner. I don't think we have to get to that extreme. But I think we can look at the day and go, where's my time of rest? Where's my time of truly giving my day to the Lord out of the other six that he has given me? For me, it's not on Sunday, obviously. For my day, it's Sunday. And people often ask me, "Well, Father, what do you do on your day off?" And my response is, "Nothing." "Oh, no, but Father, don't you go out and do this?" No, because I do that every other day of the week. So for me, I just go and just rest, watch some good movies, have a good meal. I rest. Because we need it. And yet way too many of us are so busy with so many things, catching up on everything on Sunday. And the sports thing that has creeped in, that can stop if enough parents say, we're not going to have our kids play on Sunday. You stop paying the bills for that, and by God, it will change. But we're so busy that if I go 1 hour and 5 minutes, you're mad at me. Oh, if you took forever this morning, my God. Can't Father Rafa come back? We're missing it. We're missing the importance of what we're called to do and who we're called to be. It's a day set aside for him, not for us, but ultimately it is for us because it's a time for us to just be together and worship with family, a day of rest, and just recoup the craziness of life that seems to just overwhelm us at times. Again, when I was younger, most people could leave work at work. Now people come home and they spend 2 or 3 hours on the computer doing more work because they didn't get it done, perhaps, during the day of work. And so it never stops. It's constant. And if we don't step back and go, wait a minute, I need to rest. I need to recuperate. That's not being lazy or selfish. It's providing a necessary action in the balance of our lives. God modeled this day of rest for us, a day of Sabbath, a day for the Lord. Why are we not following it? Why are we not taking the opportunity to rest in him, to not always be worrying about doing something and just being for a while? We need it. God needs the time. And he needs us to be effective ministers, and that's keeping a good balance of life in all things. So we now profess, I and let us now offer our prayers to God, who is our Almighty Father.
For the leaders of the church, may the Holy Spirit continue sanctifying and teaching them in the ways of the Lord. We pray to the Lord. Lord. For all Christians, as we continue our Lenten journey, may the Lord lead us to a deeper conversion from sin and help us experience God's compassion. We pray to the Lord. For all leaders, may God guide them in the ways of kindness and peace. We pray to the Lord. For those who are struggling, may God strengthen their faith and lessen their burden. We pray to the Lord. For the members of Transfiguration, may their faith deepen through service to others. We pray to the Lord. For the elect catechumens and candidates, that they may ponder the word of God in their hearts and savor its meaning more fully day by day. We pray to the Lord. For those who are sick, especially Father Fernando, may they find comfort and healing in the Lord. We pray to the Lord. For the repose of the soul of DJ Galvin Wheeler, for whom this Mass is offered, we pray to the Lord. For our beloved dead, especially George Eliot and Kenneth John Kirsch, may they come to dwell in the house of the Lord. We pray to the Lord. And for your own intentions held in silence.
Holy and eternal God, hear the prayers we have brought before you. Answer them in accordance with your divine providence. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord set the sacrifice for the praise of the Lord. Name our good and good of all.
Not yet. Be pleased, O Lord, with these sacrificial offerings. Grant that we who beseech pardon for our own sins may take care to forgive our neighbor through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
And let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For by your gracious gift each year, your faithful await the sacred Paschal feasts with a joy of minds made pure, so that more eagerly intent on prayer and on the works of charity and participate in the mysteries by which they have been reborn, they may be led to the fullness of grace that you bestow on your daughters and sons. And so with the angels and archangels, thrones and minions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glories without end, we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. You never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they come for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread. He gave you thanks, said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is my blood, which will be given up for you, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and confess your
therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles, glorious martyrs, and all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of the whole world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth. Your servant Francis, our Pope, Gregory John, our Archbishop, his assistant bishops, the clergy, the bishops, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned here before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed sisters and brothers, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom we bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. So we now pray as our Savior has taught us. Our deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we'll always be free from sin, safe from all distress, as we wait the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins in the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. And let us offer each other a sign of that peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
is a road meant for you to travel. Narrow and steep is the shepherd's way, and as you say yes, letting me guide you, I will be strength for the journey.
As we receive the pledge of things yet hidden in heaven and nourished while still on earth with the bread that comes from on high, we humbly entreat you, O Lord, that what is being brought about in us in mystery may come to true completion through Christ our Lord. And I can't believe I'm getting ready to lead this list of announcements in the light of today's gospel with Jesus in the temple. For sale in the narthex are Seder meal tickets. Narthex and online. Boy Scouts are pre-selling. You can order pine straw. And what else are we selling? Oh, passing out Easter eggs with information to bring back to fill Easter gift bags for the elderly and homebound. Transfiguration weekend to serve is March 16th. Stop by the table in narthex to see how you and your family can serve together. We have maintenance staff opening still. Check the website for more information. Who has a birthday to celebrate in the month of March? Happy birthday. Any anniversaries this month? Happy anniversary. Any visitors with us today? No? Okay. No visitors? It's too early. So just an explanation. I think Chet introduced himself, or he was introduced last weekend. He was here for the 7:45 Mass. Chet is a parishioner at St. Michael's. He's also a man in formation for the diaconate. He has reached the level of acolyte, and God willing, he will be ordained in this coming February, a year from February 26th. You have a countdown watch or something? February 26th. God will. When 26? Oh, shoot. Yeah, like a lifetime ago. So he's here for a pastor here. So we exchanged Wayne to St. Catherine's, and Chet is joining us for this next 9 months of time just to have a different experience of church and see a different way of things. So you might be wondering why he was standing at the altar table with me. it's an opportunity for him to learn how to be in that space and not look like he doesn't know what he's doing. So when he gets ordained, we don't sit there and go, why do we waste all of our money and formation for this guy? He doesn't know what he's doing. So the idea is to give him training and experience now so he's comfortable and at ease when he's ordained a deacon. So I can change the pages on my own, but it's an opportunity for him to learn. Well, for now I can. So ministers of caring. Please share our Lord with those that are not able to be here this day, that he be their healing and peace. Thank you. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God, oh, we got some more. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Some of you pray harder. Direct, O Lord, your, we pray, the hearts of your faithful, and in your kindness grant your servants this grace, that abiding in the love of you and neighbor, they may fulfill the whole of your commands through Christ our Lord. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We go at peace.
Oh, my Lord.